The final session today, where we're going to have a chance to have some questions from the floor, and I'm going to lead a bit of a panel discussion. I'm actually petrified I'm going to roll off the stage. if that happens, just talk amongst yourselves. Okay. So I'm going to introduce the panel back again for it. Most people were here this morning and will have heard some of the talks. So Thomas is on my left, who's the CEO and founder of Apraplan. Felix from Disperse.io. Ulrich, CEO. No, Ulrich, that is not Ulrich. This is Ulrich. This is Simon Rawlinson, everyone in the middle, who's joining us today. Simon is from Arcadis and also is part of the Construction Leadership Council. Ulrich, CEO and partner of Geniabelt. Colin, who's non-exec and spoke this morning as well. And Matt Jackson is also joining us. Gents, thank you very much. Nice and tight here, so please feel free to respond to each other as we go. I'm going to take 15-20 minutes and then we'll open it up to the floor. Simon, I'm going to start with you,
yep.
Because you weren't here this morning. What do you think of this morning's panel?
Inspirational,
yeah. That's right. So, Simon, you're just tell us a little bit about what you're doing on the Construction Leadership Council for those who aren't aware.
Right. So, Construction Leadership Council is effectively a mechanism to join up government and construction and to try and address some of the really some big structural issues that an industry such as construction faces now. Some of the material that McKinsey presented earlier this afternoon has actually formed a core part of the hypothesis that which we presented to government, which is actually to introducing change into the industry was not just good for stakeholders, but it was also good for the wider economy and for wider stakeholders, not only government itself, which of course is a massive client of the industry. So in terms of building a case for taking an industry which is known to be a very significant challenge around productivity, around its ability to attract talent, around its ability to deliver value to its clients, we have persuaded government that there's a strong case for intervention and support through what's known as the industrial strategy and a sector deal. Now the sector deal hasn't been published. Tom, over the past 3 or 4 months, has tried every means possible to extract detail from me, and he hasn't quite succeeded yet. Perhaps he's going to push me over the edge, I'm not sure. But the three components that we can talk about, one is that there's actual money which is going to be presented, which is an R&D fund, so there's something called the Industrial Strategy Challenge Fund, and industry has secured 170 million of that, which will be accessed via effectively matched funding, so effectively the construction or other partners are going to have to join in to access that funding. There's some skills funding, and there are two other really big initiatives around skills, particularly in terms of exploiting the apprenticeship levy, and around commercial models. And there's lots of conversation about Carillion and the Grenfell disaster, and those just articulate some of the challenges which we have to address. So there's really, really big problems, and I think that does then create some opportunities for people who are thinking things slightly out of the box. How are we going to transform an industry that evidently hasn't transformed itself? That's where sort of people like you come into that. So it really is a big open opportunity for people to start sort of solving real corporate problems.
Yeah, that fits on very nicely from what we heard this morning. I think Grenfell and Carillion are the two biggest examples of an industry that is broken or that has gone wrong, call it what you will, but there's clearly large opportunities. Felix, you particularly spoke very optimistically about the fact that you set out not to get into the construction industry, but you see a wealth of opportunities here. Quite interesting your idea that you shouldn't provide tech as your starting point. You should look at what where the gap is or where the problem is and provide tech as a solution to that. Having done it maybe the roundabout, or started off with doing it the roundabout way and then thinking of a tech platform first. How can you, when you look at Grenfell and Carillion, how can you adapt what you're providing to the market to respond to specific challenges?
I would first get to the first point in terms of starting with the solution first. It is something that actually, especially venture capitalists, tell you is the wrong way of doing things. So it makes sense, right? You should normally start with having the problem in mind and then and then developing the solution around the problem, right? But us having taken the wrong kind of approach to it, we are still incredibly happy where we ended up, and we see that although we are currently very, very much focused on the narrow aspects, I mean, our current focus is purely on helping planners and people who manage the projects to just get a more granular and a quicker feedback from the sites, right? We do see that the computer vision technology in general is a super generic one, right? So before we decided to focus on this aspect, we also discussed, for example, the use case of Grenfell, right? Of having of planning operations, which are also super visually distinct, right? And the different phases of them, and there is definitely the capacity of the technology to enable you to, in a way, understand whether or not there's any issues in the workflow around planning procedures and all of that, right? As I said, it's very important for an early stage startup to just find, you know, the specific first element which to focus on, and then have that as a starting point, and then from that point onwards just grow into other things. Yeah.
Rick, this is something you and I have spoken about before as well, around the need for accountability, and you know what tech firms can provide. So do you see that as being the biggest potential opportunity for a company like yourselves in terms of the UK market?
I think that in mid to long term, it's the data that's the driving opportunity. But that's maybe just another word for accountability, because that's what is needed in something like Grenfell. It is the accountability of knowing exactly who did what and when did they do it. But that's also, I think, if you flip that around, that's also what's driving the use of several of, I think, our technologies, is we provide an accountability that also protects the subcontractors, let's say. So you don't push technology into the hands of subcontractors because they're good for the clients. You push technology that's also good for the subcontractors. And you have to take that approach. You can't take the one ring to rule them, we want the data and you have to do this, because that won't work. You need to push technology in that, where accountability goes both ways. Right?
But how do you do that? Because you spoke about the fact that, you know, you start off with how to resolve something legally before you even started on the site. So how do you reach all that, you know, the client down to the subcontractor? Because constantly, I mean, Colin referred to this as well, it's been the same way for decades. You've got a fragmented supply chain. How do you do that?
I think that's not, when you persuade a client or a contractor about the inherent value of having the data and having that insight, then they can mandate it. They mandate the use of it, and if the receiving parties, they also see use for it, that process actually is possible.
I think this transparency debate actually gets to the heart of either what the opportunity for technology in construction is, or what the biggest barrier is. Because I would say that the entire industry, clients, consultants, contractors, subcontractors, have traded on ambiguity for as far back as you can possibly see. So if you were going to say at the moment, I can give you total transparency over all of your resource use and all of the mistakes that you make and others make, most people I would say is that don't want to know. But so the question then is whether you start to create use cases around, let's say, for example, Grenfell, which might say, hypothetically, you could say, I can demonstrate that every single fire break is in place, and I can validate that with a record in a sort of distributed ledger. That could be a, you know, potential IT data use case. That may suddenly start to people think, oh yeah, that actually could be useful, because we're going to see organisations are going to go to the wall because they can't demonstrate that they did what they said they'd done. But that is an almost like a, you know, a total switch in the way that the industry operated. And you could say that had Grenfell not happened, nobody would see the point of it. So that's the kind of industry we're dealing with. And then it's then how you, with utmost respect for all of the people involved in that tragedy and the way in which the implications will spread around, how you create a business model around that. Because that clearly is a very awkward situation. But it's, and I think it's absolutely the crux.
I also think that like we as construction technology startups, which and as companies that are providing new ways of structuring the data and the way of aggregating it and providing access to it and creating transparency in a way. It is incredibly important because in the way that we are structuring our systems, it does have an impact on how it is impacting each stakeholder, right? And so I think there's also quite a lot of responsibility on our side that we don't create our systems in a way that it creates a like win-win-lose situation or something like that. As like even when you know, there's clearly kind of more of opportunity or more revenue when you start at the like main contractor or developer level, right? But doing that and ignoring the impact that you could have on subcontractors and kind of just pushing them aside and not thinking of how you can design it in a way that will enable them to also do their job better and help them to do their job in a better way is really dangerous. And that's something we think every day about, how we make sure that it's actually win-win-win-win-win.
Do you want to come back to answer?
I think there are two things which are very different compared to other sectors. It's a very collaborative sector by default. One company will be working with 5 or 10 different other companies at the same time. And the other thing is, in 2012, the iPad came out. And actually, it came out in 2011, but there was no photo camera on it. And that the second dimension, I would say, on that and all the data and so on, is you have a generation who now, I'm not going to say is born with an iPad, but they've been raised with it. So the people in the field, 65% of them check in on Facebook on a daily basis. So they're used to this technology. It's actually the middle management today, which is the bottleneck. The top management, they understand why they need to do this, because then they have data, they can, and having all these dashboards, that's what they're expecting. And on the floor or on the sites, they're also looking forward to this. The middle management is the one that we need to train, because they come usually from the sites, they went up, and they are not ready for that because they're not going to say cover up, but they know there's some in the middle, and they just don't know how to articulate it. And some of the younger guys who can manipulate all these kind of Excel and stuff, they have the power of data, and that's what they see already today.
So I actually made the note, and Thomas, you said, I'm not sure who it was. I actually had it down as your point, so maybe it wasn't, forgive me. But on site, I think that is a problem. I think, you know, certainly when I talk to tier one contractors, they say that it's sometimes at a project management level, and it is guys who've been doing this for 30 years and don't necessarily want to do things through iPads and don't want to do things through using tech on site. So I just wondered, I mean, all of you, how are you getting that message? How are you able to get into construction companies and convince them of the need to do things a different way? As startups, as tech companies, how receptive are they? And how confident are you that that actually filters down? I mean, Ulrich's laughing, so that means probably it's difficult, I guess.
It sells itself. No, sorry, that was typical Danish sarcasm. I think if you go back 3 years, 4 years, the general answer was, what a magnificent piece of software, we're never going to buy it. How easy it is to use and lowly priced, but we're never going to use it, was the typical response. I don't see that resistance anymore on site. They're actually looking for technologies, and as Thomas is rightfully saying, they're educated in using consumer technologies, and they're annoyed that they have to do pen and paper processes. They don't want to go home in the evening and upload pictures from their phone and send an email. They want it done, right? So I think the selling there is exactly as Thomas said, with the middle managers, and also accepting that the biggest change and the biggest cost is not to the 4 or 5 of us here. It's for the change in turning the industry. When do I take that change? That, for the sake of a better world, is what Carillion can actually help us with. Send a very clear signal to, as you're saying, digitize or die, you need to do it now.
So, Colin, you talked about the ERP and that you've been doing this for a while, and you know, do you see any shift in terms of, let's say, maturity at the CEO board level about, you know, doing things a different way and using tech as the basis for business decisions?
Yeah, I do. I think back to the earlier point, the change will come when all the dinosaurs have died out. You know, that, and I'm one of them, you know, frankly. So I can't imagine anybody under the age of 30 that would want to go out on site with a clipboard and all that stuff. He's raising his eyes. When we developed the IW, we couldn't get people to invest in it because it was better. in the end, we commissioned Leeds to do a report for us to work out the actual cost savings by not sending drawings around on couriers. So once we proved there was an actual spend equation there that made it worth doing, then I was happy that it sold a lot of software, but I was deeply disappointed that the thing that I felt was its core attribute, which is this notion of, you know, we've heard it a lot today, one version of the truth, transparency, all that stuff, no one gave a rat's about that. If it was cheaper, you know, that was the driver. So, and I think there's still some of that. But back to why I think the stars are kind of aligning for the new technology guys now, because the raft of folks that would oppose the use of iPads and all that kind of stuff, they're all dying out. So, and people are demanding new technology. They don't want to use technologies that take a month to learn how to use and are full of all kinds of peculiar quirks that you can never get to the bottom of. People just expect to be able to use software, dial up, order stuff, get stuff done, send pictures around. You know, but so for me, if you can enable people to use the tools that they want to use, but connect it all together somehow, that to me seems to be the solution. So if you're doing some technical design work, you should be free to choose the bit of software that you'd like to use best. And you can go and buy that off the App Store or whatever, and provided that can in some way contribute to the whole, which is the challenge, then that, I think, is the way to make it all work. But the C level in construction companies, I have no doubt that they're all scouring the earth for ways in which that they can do it, you know, faster, cheaper, better, etc. But they're always thinking in terms of, oh, we need to spend a squillion quid on investing in some complete massive change of all systems and processes.
That's the point I wanted to raise. So there are tier ones who've spent tens of millions in changing back office systems in the last couple of years.
Yeah.
That's in the last couple of years as well.
Yeah, so
it's
I don't know any of those that have succeeded, that delivered any great value, and I know lots of those projects that have halted. Because they just don't have the payoff. You know, they don't have the payoff. And I think if you're in a manufacturing business and you implement a big ERP system, I think you can be reasonably sure of the outcome. But construction is just very different. It just doesn't work that way.
Matt, are you having to convince companies of you know, the need for tech? Or, you know, I think you alluded to the fact that people are approaching you now as much as the other way around.
Yeah, I mean, we've been doing this for some time, so I mean, we're in the now fortunate position where we have presence in the industry, and we get a lot of our work comes in through hearsay rather than us going out to market. But it was very different three, four years ago, where, you know, we were coming with a concept which we knew was right. We knew that the industry had to change in this way, and we knew what the benefits would be. The issue is with any startup is that you have no case study, you have no story to tell, you have no proof in the pudding, this new recipe that you have invented. Now it's not so much a problem. It's still very much an issue where I think if you talk specifically about construction companies wanting to invest in something, and your point is spot on, Colin, is that, you know, if you don't ask for £1 million, they're not interested. You go in and ask for £1 million, like, yeah, no problem at all. You go in and go, look, then do this little project for you and we'll prove it, but we only want £50,000 or £100,000. I can't give you that. We never get signed off. So there's still this mentality that I'm a big company, I need to buy from an enterprise who provide an enterprise solution. It's going to cost me 7 figures. There's still not that thinking in that, you know, actually, you know, let's go to the App Store where the Facebook generation is very much, I'm going to buy a £2 app, just £2 is going to fix a problem for me. That hasn't really got through yet, I'd say, to the really big businesses and the really big decision makers. It's just starting to, just starting.
Unfortunately, you have to justify their exponential expenditure,
yeah,
as opposed to...
I mean, £50,000, £100,000 is nothing,
yeah,
to these companies, but yeah, you have to sit and have five meetings, and it's like, guys, this is 0.0001% of your revenue.
Even when we're talking about 2-3% margins being a good thing, but at one time.
But it's a really intriguing way this conversation's going. I was just picking up the concept about the sort of clay layer, where the clay layer sits. And far from observe, I think there's an issue about not so much about driving efficiency within a single construction organisation or a design organisation. You get the process right. But actually then selling it up to clients, particularly a proposition that requires collaboration
by lots of different organisations. Let's say it's a full design team, constructors, subcontractors. Firstly, you haven't got the skills to be able to sell at the time. Then you haven't got the use case. And then you've got this really interesting, and I think quite a potentially counterproductive trend here, which is you've got lots of sort of like lots of innovation coming from below, possibly that doesn't talk to one another. And you've got this real need to get at least some degree of data sharing and consistency over the top. So as a global business, Arcadis, we struggle to get that consistency within ourselves. And certainly when you look at some of the programs we're doing, it becomes an absolute nightmare. And the barrier to you achieving at 1 × 10 × 100 is the fact that I suspect we're heading towards a Tower of Babel of lots and lots of APIs that add lots of incremental value, but in the end they don't give you that full integrated solution. And at the moment there's no real structure or sort of environment with people to do that. Maybe my digital built Brit will take us, but I'm not sure.
Following up on the bridge of the school, the two questions we ask often when we meet C-level people who are thinking about, we have a big picture about digitization, is you have somebody in charge of the data, making sure that across your different systems, if you really want to go for best of breed, you have somebody in charge of that. And the second is somebody who takes care of the knowledge. Because you're adding up a lot of knowledge from one project to another, it's not shared at all. And those are two things where middle management doesn't want to, they don't share. It's impressive what is middle management is. They're the king, they're the lords of their projects. And actually C-levels are often very afraid of them. Sometimes it's like, who is working for whom in these discussions? When
things are going wrong sometimes, middle management isn't keen to express exactly how well their projects or how well their data is being captured.
No, because it doesn't have a lot of value because it's only one project and everybody can come up with this nice dashboard with Excel. You just need to have somebody in your team with Excel. For me the question is the remark we get quite often is like it depends who we sell on the project. I know that if this person knows that project, no problem, I don't have to worry, we'll be in time within budget. If it's that one, I need to be careful. And that's the problem about the knowledge and the data. They don't have the data to compare, and they don't share knowledge between their projects. Mm-hmm. And it's this middle layer who has been doing it for many, many years that we need to convince actually to go and use technology.
And Ulrich, before I come to you, talking to the chief executive of a top 10 UK contractor recently, he said one of the biggest difficulties he still has is communicating with his staff. He's got thousands and thousands of staff, and one of the big problems is actually telling those staff, this is what we are about as a company, these are the types of values we have, these are the types of things you should be doing in terms of sharing information. Mm-hmm. So that's still a serious problem among the UN contractors who, like Caridian, problem projects, it still causes them all sorts of problems. I'll open up to the floor.
Today, your ability to communicate with people is infinitely greater than it has ever been. Mm-hmm. So that's, I agree with what you said, by the way, but I do find it annoying. The CEO can't speak to 10,000 people. I can speak to 10,000 people. I can speak to a million people.
Reply
this
on.
Afternoon, right now, if I want to. Yeah. Or, so I'll probably say something stupid. Which is
Ulrich, did you want to add?
Yeah, just one comment about the data, because that is a central point, but it's also at the same time interesting to see that governments are not putting up the demands for structurally delivering data on their projects. Right? You do that if you have a lease or if you have drawings for your building and all these old databases, that there are government structures on, if you build something for us, this is how you can just deliver that data. So you can have demands from somebody like the civil area saying, we need this, we want to structure it, and we'll adapt, right? But we can adapt if the four of us can adapt to getting the data flowing between us. And very rapidly finding out a common classification, and I'll move data from the model to me, to you, to back again. So it can be done, right? But you do need somebody stepping in with enough volume of saying, we want this, because we can learn from it, we can track it.
Who would like to ask a question of the panel? Benjamin, go with you first.
We've heard a lot about all of the raft of issues that are
the industry is dealing with right now, and there is quite a few startups entering the space. I'm just curious to know which area you think is going to be the first to have technology penetrate enough that it actually makes a sizable contribution to the way things are done. Which area is actually going to be the first to change in the industry?
When you say area, do you mean sector or
what?
Any part of the industry?
Any part of it, because there are issues across the breadth of construction. Which is the first that's going to benefit from the technology in a meaningful way?
I think I had a discussion with an investor one time. It's like, I think the point is how easy are we going to make adoption, meaning education. There's a lot of education that's needed now, but also how the cost of acquisition is still very low, but very high for the moment, because we need to educate people on using technology. And we usually make the comparison with Salesforce. What Salesforce has done 20 years ago, they actually develop a process around opportunities, accounts, and so on, which is now used by everybody in the sector. And all the new CRMs, they just copy that way of working. That's what we are actually doing now. We're educating the market about, or different users about, how they should structure their processes so they can do it in a repeatable way. And that's, I don't know which one it's going to be, but I think the biggest challenge for us is actually finding the best way to educate the users, middle management, and the CEOs on all of these things, and with cost efficient.
I think actually, despite the skew of the question, I think the biggest change is going to be because the way we need to build is going to change. That is, at the moment, every single building we build is a prototype. We don't have commonality between, you know, let's say we have 200 schools. Every single school will be uniquely designed. That is absolutely crazy. I mean, the Department of Education knows exactly what needs to go into a classroom for 30 people. We know exactly what the equipment needs to be. We know exactly what resources the staff need to be able to deliver to a classroom. So I think what will happen will be that we are part of a project, and there's an excellent piece of writing done by Bridenwood, which was released last year, which is about prefabrication manufacturing in the construction process. And it talks about how can we modularize construction off-site? How can we build in a factory, in a controlled environment? And how can we bring those big, big pieces to site and build quicker and better through a much richer controlled specification process? Now, you can't do that actually without any of us actually sitting here. We all still need to be involved in that process because we can enrich that process and make that process really, really possible. So I think the biggest disruption will be that the demand, the on-site demand, and I think looking into the Carillion failure and these inefficiencies on the site, that was 7 to 15% gets torn down again, I think, at the beginning of the talk. It's unacceptable. So the way we build will be disrupted, and therefore the way that all the technologies around the way we build will also disrupt the traditional method, I think. So I'm sorry to skew the questions.
Yeah, no.
All right, go on. Sure.
I read that you're seeing the first private clients who have volume, and house builders are a good way to start because they have small, repetitive, fairly low complicated projects. So they're good at actually looking at that process. But you will see the first clients now beginning to say, I'll design my house with the clients in the cloud. They can move around things, and I'll instantly transform that into a plan. And the second I transform that into a plan, that plan will order the materials, it will order the machines, it will put it on site, and the guys who are actually building, they meet there, and the materials and the machines are there, and they just pay for their skills. So I think that the slightly skewed answer is that a combination of the technologies that are available now will actually change fundamentally the way you build. I don't think there's going to be one that just
leaps at it. I'll skew it again. If one takes the patterns of investment that are occurring in the US at the moment, I'd say that probably that the initial focus is more likely to be on contractors who have the most to do. So applications that help them de-risk delivery projects on site is probably the area where most people will focus on, because it doesn't necessarily rely on all of these network effects to deliver value. You just do it on the site, it works there. But if you were looking forward a few years in terms of where the real value is, I don't think it's actually construction, I think it's existing asset. And so it is actually, it's capturing data around existing assets to support much better decision making around repair and maintenance, increasing utilisation. If one looks at the Digital Built Britain initiative, so again that's a big chunk of the construction strategy I talked about earlier. In the end, it wasn't the 100 billion that we spend per annum on construction that got government excited. It was 600 billion of GDP that is associated with the way that assets operate, schools, railways, roads, what have you. So in the end, the real prize is actually it's the existing assets rather than the new ones.
And some work being done around the infrastructure projects authority around looking at existing assets and whole life value, which again came up this morning, which is crucial. More questions. Paul, I think,
yep.
You want to get, and then this gentleman in the back.
Okay. It's clear from the panel that the discussions that we had that the technologies arise, which is fantastic news.
Paul, just say who you are as well, sorry.
Hi, I'm Paul Bamforth. And I was just going to say, it's pretty clear from the TED Talks and everything else that the technologies arise. It's really exciting to hear what's been said. And obviously also what was said earlier about we have an industry that's not in a very healthy state in some respects, you say. So if we were starting again with the technologies we have on the stage, we wouldn't do it the way we're doing it. But the fact is, we have got the industry that we have. And I was just wanted to ask the panel, because obviously the key is for the people in the industry to recognise the pain, because those of us who've sold software, if somebody doesn't recognise pain, they don't invest, they don't change. And have you got any examples that actually now can give us confidence that people are willing to change that process, whether it's the client or the main contractors? Because really what's exciting here is you've got a key that unlocks a door. But until people are willing to release that handbrake, the main contractors or the clients, we could be here again for another 5, 10 or whatever length of time. So is there anything that you find that can give confidence that people truly are now ready to change? Because, you know, yeah, in terms of real examples of companies that are already moving in the UK industry or elsewhere.
Thomas, do you want to start?
So on the back of the project of the school, so it was 150 schools, we basically now entered a partnership with 60 biggest contractors to standardize all of their on-site processes.
It's in Belgium.
It's in Belgium. So they are really aware that this is happening, and I would say it's a typical bell curve or crossing the chasm. So yeah, these projects that we give up are the innovators. And we're getting into, we see more and more motion in getting the early majorities and so on. So it's probably going back to the middle management. We're gonna take a generation before everybody is going to go all in. But it's such a big segment that, I mean, even the 16 or 20% or 33% is huge. So what we need to do today is find who are the guys who are really serious about going digital, serious about changing this. These are the sales calls that we make, is identifying, does he have the power? Is there any person who is blocking a train to go here? So from our point of view, there are many examples that we can bring here. I think what's happening today is the technology is there, and the mindsets of some of the people are ready. But is everybody ready? Of course not. It's probably going to take another 10, 15 years before you go where the manufacturing is today. But even 23% of the big sector is a lot of money.
Right. Yeah, I think there are examples. One to get with, we were working with a house builder, they build around 1,500 houses a year, and they've been, for the last 11 years, they've had higher revenues, higher margins, and they're owned by Capital Fund, which is an interesting fact, because they've seen that they've taken that manufacturing approach and said, okay, we can actually start working with these processes. So the digital tools that they're looking at are actually becoming the backbone of their organization. Right? So they're slimming their own organization, replacing it with technology, but still with an acute knowledge about how to sell a house to a family. So there are a ton of good stories out there. And we heard many of them. Some of them, they are there, but we're still looking, and that's also why we have this today. The growth we're doing and the global approach we're doing takes a lot of cash to get up and running, because this is not a cheap transition. But there are a ton of good cases documented.
Travel, Matt, anything to add in terms of existing case studies in the UK?
Yeah, I think there's lots of companies that are investing. I'd agree with what you said earlier. It's about finding those early adopters. I've certainly done that with my companies, where you find some organisations are kind of front of the queue, really, in terms of adopting new technologies. And it's about working with those to prove out the use case and the investment value. And then the next thing that needs to happen is that needs to be shared with the industry. And I think that's one of the failings, in a way, is there's a lot of talking that goes on, but there's not really an awful lot of sharing of good practice. So I think that's... as far as I'm concerned, I think the case is proven in terms of technology. The industry will buy technology quite happily, provided the use case can be satisfied. You've only got to look at the skyline and see a whole bunch of cranes that cost an awful lot of money. There's a simple arithmetic calculation that can be done on whether it's worth it. We need to do the same with IT. So if we can develop solutions that address some of the problems that I've outlined, and you can prove that they either can increase transparency, reduce cycle times, accelerate payment, put more working capital into the system, those kinds of things, I think people will buy that.
Gentlemen, back.
Thanks, yeah. Hugo Dorf. and my question is actually a little bit related to, I think, Paul's question before, but I think it's an important one. So we're sitting here under the Contech moniker, which means that there is a premise here in the room that there is an acceleration or an inflection point. There's an acceleration coming in adoption of technology and construction. So what's your best indicator, what's your best proof point, what's your best story that shows that we are about to that this is about to take off? Colin touched a little bit upon this in your presentation.
Well, I'll give you proof positive. Oracle have spent getting on for a couple of $1 billion on buying companies in this space in the last 2 years. They've gone to the trouble of creating a global construction and engineering business unit that didn't exist a short while ago. there's proof, guys. I think if you look at the big vendors, they've stayed away from construction. Every few years or so, they dip a toe in the water and then move away hurt. This is not dipping a toe in the water. They've absolutely jumped into the bath fully. I think you'll see that expenditure accelerate. They're doing some amazing things. So,
the doors are opening as well.
So the corporate team at Oracle obviously feel that this is a space that's worth investing in, and they've got quite a lot of brain power and an awful lot of spending power to inflict on it.
We had a really good talk at one of our events recently, and he's written a book on called Sharkonomics. Sharkonomics is an idea that if you sit comfortable, a shark is going to come up behind you. You don't see the shark until the last minute, and it eats you, and it eats your company. And there are worrying signs if in this industry, if we don't change, that will happen. There will be more Kodak moments in this industry where those who are comfortable, whether it be in construction or software or architects or facility management, any part of the industry at all, and there's some mumblings and interesting stories that Google are going to build a town in America. And Google are going to build this and offer the housing to those who need it at no cost. But what they're going to do is that they're going to fill these homes with IoT devices, and they're going to use it as a social experiment. They're going to identify the behavioral habits of humans inside the home, and then use that to influence their data cloud to enrich technologies. Now, it sounds terrible, I don't like it either. I think it's terrible. So this is happening because the industry is not responding fast enough.
I'm not saying for one second that Google are going to become conscious. I'm merely using it as an example of how something could not work in our favour. On a positive point, before Simon shouts at me, there are excellent working cases within British government and other governments globally of really looking at the way that they tender for something. Going back to the schools example, we are working with a government department who, in the UK, we have a working case, and a case study will be released soon, where they have standardised a design. And they had information inside their system that they couldn't share. They had a 2 GB local file. Can't share it. It's really difficult to share files of such size and influence internally just how you tender for something, but also then all the contractors around it, all the architects as well. It's a huge struggle. And we have assisted them in breaking that up into sizable chunks where the work that they have done is amazing. They have standardized a whole department's way of designing and procuring something. They just need a little bit of help to share it and get that data streaming. And the want is there in civil service and in the private sector. The want is there. There's just that little spark of finding that tool or us being introduced to them to make that flow of data.
Nice try, Matt, but our headline's still going to be Google is going to become contractor.
But the point is really interesting. Look at Amazon and what it's doing with high street retail,
yep.
Or look at Legal in general getting into housing and offsite. You know? So there are definitely going to be major tech providers who are going to be disruptors in this space. Did you want to come back?
How many people have read The Circle in this room?
Yep.
I mean, just I think we know where that one's going.
Read the book.
The two things I will say, I think I'm building on the point about government. I think there's a really reassuring thing about actually government starting to sound coordinated and joined up. So you can read about 4 or 5 different pieces of work, industrial strategy, the NIC stuff about data, you've got the transport efficiency strategy, you've got transforming infrastructure performance. It's all sounding like there's somebody in the public sector who gets it and is actually persuading other people to think that way. So that's encouraging, because otherwise you wouldn't actually have the confidence that that is going to flower and multiply from one platform to another. So that's great. The only thing I will say, and I think this is something that the industry has, which is this amazing ability to make itself uninvestable. And so there's that. We continue to have to watch the industry the way it can coalesce around platforms, it can coalesce around large-scale programs, roads, schools, housing. Because if that stuff doesn't happen, actually it's going to be really difficult to create momentum around what you describe as high-level technological innovation rather than the stuff right down on the side. So it does need a sort of pretty consistent way of working across the industry.
Any final? Yes.
There is a mic coming very slowly.
No, that lady here.
Right. Jump in and ask the question for you.
I'll translate.
I'm Irene from Jones Lang LaSalle. You mentioned about the software, and the want is there for us, those who really need the software. But how do we find out what's right for us? Because I work as a surveyor, and within Jones Lang LaSalle, we've got lots of, we've got the project managers, the building surveyors, and there's us, the architects, and it's so difficult to work with that one place where you can find the information you need. So as a partial surveyor, before works can begin on site, I need to make sure the award is in place. But to get that done, I need information from all the designers and the contractors, and sometimes it's just frustrating to get that information in one place. So what would be the best software for that?
If I can take a shot at it, it starts with your own organization. It starts with, as Thomas is saying, we can be a band-aid for an immediate pain, but in order for any of the things that we're building to become a part of your operating system, the processes within the company, needs to be defined. Personally, we meet and so say rising amount of companies who identify they have a need, and then they spend the first 3-4 months, and then it actually ends with a talk that's much broader than just what we're doing about how are the processes, what is it you want to achieve, and how do you want to own the data, and what do you want to, how do you want to, so there are a lot of questions that a lot of construction companies are not necessarily asking themselves. So they identify one need, I need the quality assurance data from site, I'll go and find an app. Okay, then I have it, what do I do with it? Well, I put it on a server. So you need to go through that maturity process, right? which I at least experienced that not all companies are doing.
Can I add to that? I think also that thought process you've just described of going away to solve a problem, come back to having lots of questions about lots of problems, is the way to buy enterprise. That is an enterprise approach, not a let's solve a little problem first, fixed, and then trusting. And you know, we're not 100% there yet, but trusting the industry to go, okay, well, I've solved that problem, and I know that all these new startups who are really cool are going to share that data with me resolving my next problem. That is the way that you should ask questions, is that, so you identify a problem, you go, okay, could you provide me with a solution? And when you've solved that problem, are you, before we start doing this, are you open to connect to my other problems? And if you can't fix it, I'm going to find somebody else, and will you connect to them? So the way you shape those questions are very different to buying an ecosystem to an enterprise. The questions are fundamentally different.
This is where we see some of our clients who are more mature. That's the question they ask. It's also in their advantage because it means they can switch us on and off. And so it's like, do you have an API? These are kind of what kind of API it is. How can you interface? We have experience interfacing as well. So I think it builds on, you need to find, and it's, I think also what you said earlier on, is solving micro problems, but making sure that the data comes up. That's why we ask those two questions about, do you have somebody who's making sure of data integrity and the knowledge? Because if you don't have that, you will be continuously stuck with that issue. It's not something we can solve. As company, we can just make you aware, and that's the education the market needs to go through.
Yes, just a perspective that we've developed within Arcanis, and something which worked very successfully for us for the past 18 months, is a collaborative approach which we're working with our clients with a much broader ecosystem of partners, collectively to identify and sort of start to solve problems. So it's a workshop approach, quite immersive, 4 days of getting people to look at some quite crunchy big problems rather than necessarily some quite incremental ones. But I think it's partly having process, so we use this sort of design thinking process, which I think is pretty well established in this kind of industry, and then bringing a whole lot of skills into the room. So it's not just Arcadis, it's going to be the IBMs, it's going to be the Deloittes, and it's going to be some of the SME sort of data and IT specialists to start creating those ideas. So I think there's lots of different ways of sort of addressing these problems, but I think the principle of having more than one person in the room, I think, is a really important way of accelerating the route to the solution.
Final question, gentlemen.
Hi, this builds a bit on what Matt said and how we're moving into controlled environments and effectively manufacturing processes for buildings, whether it's modular or panel. But at the end of the day, we are, if building something in a rainy field was more efficient, that's where we'd be building cars and iPhones, but we're doing that in factories. So presumably the construction industry over short and long is going to move in that direction. To what degree do you then, for the entrepreneurs on the panel, see a threat from existing IT in manufacturing environments that would make your technology effectively redundant because the process of construction has changed so fundamentally by moving into that controlled environment that effectively the solutions for the issues already exist?
Yeah, I mean, for us, the example between manufacturing and construction is a really good one because we take a lot of inspiration out of the way that machine vision is enhancing manufacturing, right? As in, they were doing it in a very similar way, right? They both through policy control, workflow management, and so on, right? Machine vision is in that way helping an incredible amount in terms of productivity in manufacturing. So it's great inspiration for us. We don't see it as a big threat because the way that machine vision works, and this is not to say that many machine vision companies aren't working towards becoming more a computer vision based. Therefore, I mean, instead of just looking at things on the pixel level, they actually understand what they're looking at, right? But I think we know, like, nobody wants to move to a place, and that's also not really what is happening right now, I feel, in the whole modernization trends, where construction is literally like manufacturing, where every house looks like the same, right? Modular construction should still be that you're building different types of buildings and you're just prefacturing compact units that you can deliver onto the sites, but the composition of those will be different from room to room, and you keep that sense of, you know, creativity for architects and all of that, right? And this is what our technology is necessary for, and we are happy to also move that to pre-manufacturing plants and so on, right? But fundamentally, what is necessary for these companies to have in this environment is that the systems need to deal with the fact that in construction is not manufacturing. You can't, on the pixel by pixel level, just look at things in the same way, right? There is an inherent amount of variability in construction, in the data, in the way that you operate, in all of it. And this is why we feel machine learning is so great, because machine learning can deal, and especially deep learning can deal with a bit of variability, not too much, but it's the amount of variability that there is in construction is something that we can cope very well with.